Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to worship here at Aberlour Parish Church, and especially warm welcome to anyone joining us as visitors. Just before we begin, just to let you know, I didn't pre-record a service this week. Maybe not, I've been doing pre-recorded services, and it didn't work out. All of the technical things happened. What I've told on our Facebook page that I would do would be film this service. So that tripod there is filming the service, all the folk that will watch this later. Just so as you know, I mean, none of you are in the front anyway, but you can't be seen and you shouldn't really be heard either, because the speaker will take it. I hope that's okay, but you certainly won't be seen in any recording. We come to worship this week, and after trawling through the lesser known parts of the Old Testament and Ezra for 4 weeks, we're going to take a wee break and be back in the New Testament for a few weeks, thinking about creation, but creation in the Gospels. So this week we come to a reading that, after having had so many unfamiliar readings, is much better known to us. Our call to worship then comes from the Psalms, and the Psalms which celebrate God's creation. And you're invited to join in with the text in bold. From Psalms 24 and 150. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. God made land on the waters. All things were fashioned by God's hand. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So let us worship, and if you're following in the hymn books, at hymn number 181, 181, For the Beauty of the Earth.
Thank you.
Let's pray. God, three and one, we pray bringing our thoughts to you now. Loving Creator, you are the spark of life behind the universe. From the infinite to the invisible, you are the source of goodness in all things. From the magnificent to the microscopic, we come to you now, asking that you'd open our eyes to your gifts, and in awe, worship you. Loving Son, you are the friend of all people, from the smallest child to the most senior of citizens. You are the teacher we all need, for the first and the last of us. We come to open our minds to your words, and in humility we listen. Loving Spirit, you are the fire burning within us, from passion and compassion. You are the wisdom that brings new life for creatures great and small. We come to open our hearts to your transforming power, and in anticipation we wait. Loving God, Creator, Son, and Spirit, you are life itself. You are wisdom. You are compassion. And you are bound together in holy love. So as we come before you now, open our lives and bind us together to be a holy, loving community, worshipping and following you. Loving God, we come confessing that not all we do or say is right. Before your life-giving power, we remember the times that we have caused pain or hurt, or have made choices that affect the earth's ability to sustain life. Before your wisdom, we admit the times when we have been willfully ignorant, have not been willing to seek or hear guidance from you or from those around us. Before your compassion, we confess the times that we have not looked on others with the care they deserve, or have not been willing to listen to stories of lives beyond our own. Before your love, we open our lives in honesty and humility, knowing there are so many actions done and left undone that cause you pain. And before your love, we listen to your promise of forgiveness and of healing. That which allows our hearts to be changed and our lives to be made new through the loving touch of Jesus Christ, who's our friend and our teacher, and who taught us to pray together when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We sing again, and if you're following in the hymn book at number 240, God in such love lent us this planet. comes from the Gospel of Luke, Luke chapter 19 and verses 29 through 40. Let's listen for the Word of God. When Jesus had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it.'" So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They said, "The Lord needs it." Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." Amen. We sing again at hymn number 122, 122 in our hymn books. "Let all the world in every corner sing, My God and King." God, as we come now to consider your word for us today, we ask that you send your spirit among us, and you'd find in us ready minds and hearts open to being changed by your love for us. Amen. We know this episode that we've just read. But we normally read it at a very different time of year, on Palm Sunday, the week before Easter. It's a reading that evokes palm branches waving, processions in the streets. Sometimes churches even manage to get a donkey to come along to the Sunday service. So it might seem a little out of season reading it just now. Yet as we've just been singing about all creation saying, "My God and King," this is the moment in the Gospels when Jesus is publicly recognized once and for all as the King, the Messiah, God's. Of course, the crowds didn't completely understand what that might mean for Jesus to be the King. Even as Jesus himself tried to hint that he was not the sort of king they were expecting, choosing for his triumphal entry not a stallion warrior horse, but a humble donkey. And the crowds in turn, when given a king that they didn't expect, didn't take long to reject him, crowning him with a crown of thorns as he was nailed to a cross. So they didn't get it completely. But while it was a fleeting and imperfect understanding of Jesus as King, this remains a moment of recognition of Jesus as Lord. And just as some in the crowd wanted to stop, telling Jesus to disperse the crowds, we get this quite wonderful line. "I tell you, if the crowds were silent, the very stones would cry out." We have to imagine that Jesus is engaged in a metaphor here. It's hard to imagine the mechanics of how a stone would actually cry out, so it might not be the most miraculous thing that ever happened in the Gospels. But what I read in a statement like that is that just as Jesus is revealed to be King, the King that Jesus is a King for the whole of creation. And the whole of creation, stones and all, witness to God's glory in Christ. In recent centuries, Christian thought and worship has too narrowly focused on how God relates to humanity, over and above, often at terrible neglect to, God's relating to the whole of creation. And yet we know that God relates to the whole of creation. It's a testimony of much of the Bible. In the beginning, at Genesis, God creates the heavens and the earth and the land and the sea and all the animals before humanity. However we read those 6 days or moments or movements of creation in Genesis, we know that in biblical narrative, as well as scientific evolutionary understanding, all of the rest of the planet and creation was here before us. God relates to creation. Just as creation in all its splendor praises God, the Psalms are full of imagery about the whole of creation. Our call to worship borrowed only from Psalm 24 and 150, but the theme is there in so many other places too. And this seems to be the sort of thing that Jesus is picking up when he talks about the very stones crying out. That the earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. Which means that, insofar as we humans inhabit the earth, insofar as we enjoy it, insofar as we use its resources, insofar as we use the earth for our own ends and our own needs, we do it only because God has permitted us to, and God has gifted the riches of the earth to us. And yet for something so important as God's gift to us, we know we have been woefully neglectful. While we're thinking about these stones and rocks, stones that might cry out, it's interesting and yet alarming to tell us what stones today tell us of our world, how deep a scar we're leaving. We think of stone, rock, as unchangeable, as solid, as defiant. Nothing changes a rock. They've been here for millions, sometimes billions of years, and they're not going anywhere anytime soon. And yet in recent centuries, the field of geology has revealed to us some of the ways in which Earth's crust and the rock and stone which we stand on tells us about Earth's history, through epochs and ages lasting millions upon millions of years. Eons given names like the Cambrian period, the Devonian, the Jurassic with its dinosaurs and fossils, the Miocene, layers and layers of types of rock preserving the history of the Earth, the ancient roots of our planet. And yet, in radically short space of time, compared to these millions, billions of years, we have learned how to manipulate the rock and its stores of coal and oil and gas to power our industrial revolutions, to produce electricity, to power transport. And now, these same geologists who study the layers of the Earth's history tell us that we, as humans, in the tiny space of time we've been on the planet, and in the even tinier space of time that we've had access to fossil fuels, have left a footprint that will be evident for millions of years to come. They talk now of a new geological age, the Anthropocene, the age of humanity, which will record for millennia, millions of years to come, the most rapid rise in global temperatures possibly ever seen, and all the markers that come with that. Increased carbon dioxide levels kept in the soil, ice caps melting, and all the climate markers that you can tell from Earth. A new layer of the Earth's history is being left behind, and it will feature the damage that we've done. One of the features of this new layer is this new substance, which will outlive us all, possibly outlive our species: plastic. We're only beginning to understand the ways that plastic creeps into every feature of the environment. Never again will our Earth be like how it was before we walked its surface. And so far, the tale of humanity's influence on the Earth has been one of destruction. We have made extinct hundreds, thousands of other species. There is near universal toxification of water, of soil, of air. There is much to be grieved because of our lack of care for God's creation. We sometimes treat environmental issues as if it's for scientists and environmentalists and politicians to fix and to worry about. And while we might wish them well in that task, we too often can see it as a sort of peripheral concern for those of us in the church. And yet, as Christians, precisely as Christians, we say that from the beginning, the Earth wasn't ours to do this to. It's God's. God has charged us to take care of creation. So yes, it's a job for scientists and politicians to take action, but actually care for creation sits right at the core of who we are as Christians, at the core of our theology and our worship and our calling as a church. Because if those stones that once upon a time would have cried out for praise of Jesus were to cry out now, I fear it wouldn't be in jubilation, but we might imagine they'd cry out in rage and in fear for the future of the planet, crying out for us to recognize the plight of the world, to change our actions, our consumption, our thoughtless greed. If today we would want to number ourselves among those who in the crowd proclaimed Jesus as King, then we would have to recognize that Jesus is King of all creation. And then see ourselves as not the only inhabitants of Christ's kingdom, but subjects along with the whole of creation. As a church, as individuals, the charge is on us to recognize the plight of our environment and to take up our responsibility to care and to change. When we do the right things, when in our daily lives we make choices that help rather than hinder the environment, we do so as a good and a right thing to do, but also as a faithful response to God's relating to us, as an act of faith. As the focus of our world and our society turns soon to the COP26 summit, which is coming to Glasgow, we will be hosting in Scotland on our doorstep a meeting that will have the power to make decisions which might begin, we hope, to redress the damage that our species has done to our planet. So as they meet, we ought to lobby, to campaign and to pray, as well as doing our own bit and making the changes that are needed in our own lives. And when we do it, as Christians, we will do it not just because it's the right thing to do, not just because everyone should be doing it, but because our faith reveals to us a God who loves all of creation and calls us to love it and to care for it as well. Amen. We sing again, and if you're in the hymn book at hymn number 243, touch the earth lightly, use the earth gently.
Thank you.
With our prayers for the world, we come before God. Let's pray. God of justice, throughout history you have called us to listen to your messengers, proclaiming hope and challenging our destructive desires. As the message of climate science continues loud and clear, may its urgency be heard by politicians and leaders, and by every one of us who must make changes. As the voices of the most vulnerable are heard, through global movements and partnerships, may we recognise them as our neighbours and truly hear them. As the self-interested resist the changes called for by those crying out, may we stand together with others to protect their lives and their rights. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of love, you have shown us how to love and welcome all people, especially remembering the least, the poorest, and the marginalized. Where there are people who have few choices or chances because of poverty, may we work to transform the systems that limit their lives. When anyone is turned away from safety and refuge, or driven from their home by occupation, violence, stigma, or desperation, may we offer welcome in your name. Where livelihoods are lost because of the choices of developed nations, may we play our part in finding practical solutions and offering a real future. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Spirit of truth, you move in us and among us all, as a fire in our bones, as a breath that sustains us. For those who need to be challenged to listen, to hear, and to change, may you fill our hearts and minds for them. For churches, communities, and nations who need to act, may you inspire our actions, leading us in your way of peace. For those who need comfort, as they live with loss or fear or pain, may you be with them. May you be in us and around us as we seek to be your hands acting in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all time, of all ages, we bring to you now our specific prayers for this time and moment. As nations prepare to meet in Glasgow for the COP26 summit, may they be prepared for serious and difficult change for the good of all. As we have witnessed this week, the horror and aftermath of mass shootings in Plymouth, we pray for comfort and peace amidst the most senseless violence. And as we learn more that the attacker's motive was misogyny, we pray for an end to the many forms of violence against women. We pray for the people of Haiti in the aftermath of a deadly hurricane, for those grieving the many and increasing number of lives lost there. We pray for the people of Afghanistan, whose future, in light of the Taliban taking control in many areas, leaves very little certain, except that there will be yet more violence. God, these are just some of the situations that flash across our screens, that leap out to us from the newsprint. Yet we know too that there are so many other situations, both known and unknown to us. But you know. We remember our world before you, God. And we remember that it is, in truth, your world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. Nothing much by way of intimation this week, except that, for the first time in a long, long time, we're able to share in tea and coffee after the service here in Aberlour. If you've got a paper order of service that explains some of what we'll do and how we'll do it, and the chief points being that for tea and coffee we'll have to remain seated, just as we would in a cafe or a restaurant at the moment, and tea and coffee will then be served at the table by Heather and Isabel. Huge thanks to Heather for organising all the arrangements that we need to do to make this work with our COVID restrictions. But we're able to do it. We're very happy that we're able to do it. The only other thing is, we're also aware that not everyone will yet feel comfortable doing that. So if there are people who just want to go and remain socially distant and all of that, but while the rest of us might sit down, we will give those people plenty of space in order to do that. And you know, there's never any pressure, especially if you're not feeling like that's something you want to do yet. But you can join us, and you're all very welcome to join us for tea and coffee after the service. Our final hymn is in our hymn book at number 246, 246. And if you're following and you like to read the tunes, you'll find that it's not that tune that we're singing it to, but the familiar tune of Lord for the Years, which is that 159 if you really want to look it up. But the words are, Great God of every shining constellation.
Thank you.
love and to serve God. God, the creator of green and growth. God, redeemer, whom stones cry out for. God, the Spirit, who breathes life into the world. And may the blessing of this God, ever three and ever one, be with you this day and always.